Today we'll be seeing introduction to tissues of body. So I'll be following Cunningham's manual of anatomy, first volume, introductory sections. So what are the coverings of the body? There are three coverings. From superficial to deep skin, superficial fascia, and the deep fascia. So these are the structures that you will be encountered during dissection. Then deep to deep fascia, muscles are present. Deep to that, there is deep neurovascular bundle which contains nerves, arteries, veins. Deep to that, there are bones. In case of thorax and abdomen, in addition to these structures, inner aspect contains viscera. Viscera are the inner organs, like in thorax, lungs, heart. In abdomen, there are organs like stomach, liver, and so on. So this picture is showing the part of the hand after removing the deep fascia, where muscles are exposed. Tendons are also can be seen in this area. Superficial fascia is seen below the skin. This is the skin. Now when cutting the skin, superficial fascia is exposed, which is filled with fat. So skin has got two layers, epidermis and dermis. Now epidermis is superficial and dermis is deep. Now superficial fascia is connecting the dermis to underlying deep fascia. This is skin, superficial fascia is here. Skin has epidermis and dermis. Deep to that, superficial fascia is present. That is going to connect the skin, the dermis of the skin, to the deep fascia. Deep fascia is present superficial to the muscles. These are muscles. And they are the general coating of the body, which is seen beneath the skin throughout the body. Usually fat is deposited in the superficial fascia, especially in regions like buttocks, lumbar regions, anterior abdominal wall, and also mammary gland. Some areas like eyelid, fat is very thin. Not only the fat, but also we have small arteries, veins, lymph vessels, and nerves which are running in superficial fascia. These are called as superficial structures. This is a picture showing a nerve which is seen in the superficial fascia. These areas are yellow colored area are the superficial fascia. So these are branches of terminal branches of facial nerve. So they serve as a soft medium for the passage of nerves and vessels, as we discussed before, and it also conserves body heat because fat is a bad conductor of heat. This picture, the skin can be seen, skin is reflected. The superficial fascia, which is yellow colored, can be seen. Muscles are exposed. Superficial to the muscles, there is deep fascia. This area is a chest region. Now, in this picture, the deep fascia is exposed to show the underlying deep structure, that is muscle. Deep fascia is a fibrous sheet which is inelastic and tough. It also lines the part of the body that is deep to superficial fascia. And it is devoid of fat. These are well seen in the limbs, but not defined on the trunks and face. Deep fascia in some areas get modifies into intermuscular septum. Intermuscular septum is an extension from the deep fascia to the bone. This is a cut section of the arm where humerus can be seen, and the deep fasciae surrounding the muscles sends a septa that reaches the bone from either side. These are called as intermuscular septa. They divide the region of arm into flexor compartment and extensor compartment. The area in front of the humerus, anterior to the humerus, anterior to these two intermuscular septa, is called flexor compartment. Whereas the posterior aspect, we have extensor compartment. So this is the medial intermuscular septa, and this is lateral intermuscular septa. So the orientation of septa differs in different regions of the body. As this area is a forearm, here the orientation is slight different. Similarly, another modification of deep fascia is it is going to invest muscle on the outer aspect as epimysium. It also sends its septa inside to cover bundle of muscle fiber called perimysium. Even it again sends its septa to the each muscle fiber to form endomysium. Epimysium, perimysium, which covers or which encircles a bundle, and endomysium, which is going to encircle each muscle fiber. Similar to that, deep fascia invests the nerve on the outer aspect of the nerve as epineurium, and covering a bundle of nerve fibers as perineurium, and each nerve fiber as endoneurium. Here the name changes here. This is epineurium. In the muscle, we call it as epimysium. It also surrounds large arteries and veins. Like in the axilla, it is going to cover axillary vessels called axillary artery. In the carotid region, neck, it is going to cover the arteries, vessels as carotid sheath. As it covers the vessels, when it reaches the vein, the deep fascia is loose so as to allow the distension of the vein. Deep fascia is thickening, or deep fascia thickens in some part of the body as retinaculum. As in the ankle, this is extensor retinaculum of the ankle. This is extensor retinaculum of the wrist. This is to support the structures which are passing deep to the retinaculum. In some areas like palm, it is thickened to form palmar aponeurosis, and in the sole as plantar aponeurosis. When the two bones are coming close with each other, like in leg and forearm, the deep fascia thickens in between the bones to form interosseous membrane. In between osseous bones. So in between the bones, interosseous membrane is a modification of deep fascia. It keeps the two bones at optimal distance and also provides an area for attachment of muscles. Muscles get attached to the bones as well as interosseous membrane. Also transmitting weight from one bone to the other. There are some terms which are used for the vessels commonly. There are three layers for a vessel, starting from inner to outer: tunica intima, tunica media, and tunica adventitia. This is heart. From the heart, arteries arise, which carries oxygenated blood to the tissue. As the arteries move, they divide, branch like a tree, becomes smaller and smaller, and forms arterioles. Arterioles again divides and form capillaries. Capillaries unite to form venules. Smaller venules joins to form veins. Larger veins are called vena cava. These are vena cava, superior and inferior vena cava. They are going to drain into the heart. So capillaries are microscopic vessels which cannot be seen with naked eyes, and it is present at the tissue level. Now anastomosis. Anastomosis is the point where two blood vessels merge with each other. There are three types of anastomosis: arteriovenous anastomosis, venous anastomosis, arterial anastomosis. So here the arteries are forming capillaries, then forms venules and forms the vein. This happens normally, but in anastomosis, as here, the arteries, before forming the capillaries, they anastomose with each other. Similarly, venous anastomosis, after formation of capillaries, the veins are joining with each other to form venous anastomosis. And the third type is arteriovenous anastomosis. Here, the arteries bypasses the capillaries and directly joining with veins. So arteriovenous anastomosis are also called as shunt. Now the importance of arterial anastomosis is that it provides a collateral circulation to a tissue. This is seen in some part like heart, where there are a lot of anastomosis between right and left coronary arteries. Now arteries are the one which carries oxygenated blood from the heart to the tissue. The largest artery that you have is aorta, which is having a diameter of 2.5 centimeter. Now, as I said before, arteries divide and divide into smaller branches and reaches at the tissue level, forming the capillaries. The smallest arterial vessel is called as arterioles, which is less than 0.1 millimeter in diameter. Arterioles forms capillaries, and capillaries going to form venules. So capillaries are network of microscopic tubules, and they are lined by endothelial cells, which are flat cells, simple squamous cells. So transportation occurs at this level, or exchange of substances occurs at this level, at the capillary level, where the tissues receives oxygen from the blood, which is flowing in the capillary, and the waste materials that is produced by the cell is transported into the blood through the endothelial cells. Now veins are going to carry deoxygenated blood from periphery to the heart. The blood flow in the vein is sluggish when compared to the blood flow in the artery, because in the artery, blood flows with pressure. That pressure is generated by the heart. Whereas in vein, there is no pressure. Pressure is very minimal. There are some factors which helps to venous to have a better venous return. There are many factors. I'm just discussing two. The first one is pressure applied on veins by contracting leg muscles. Leg muscles like soleus, which is called as peripheral heart. Soleus is a muscle which is called as peripheral heart, which has a lot of veins inside. So when the muscle contracts during walking, the veins inside the muscle gets compressed, and the blood which is there in the blood get pushed to upside, to the upper aspect. The blood which is already pushed to the upper aspect can return down when the muscle relax, but that does not happen because of the valves which are present in the veins and likely to arteries. So the veins are present on the veins, I'm sorry, the valves are present on the veins, and these valves will prevent the opposite movement of the blood, that is the movement of blood to the lower aspect. Similarly, there are two types of veins in the body, a deep vein and a superficial vein. Deep veins are seen with the muscles, deeper muscles, whereas superficial veins are seen in the superficial fascia. There is always a flow of blood from superficial to or superficial veins to deep veins. Again, there are valves which are present at this location. So the blood always flow from superficial to deep, never from deep to superficial, because these valves will not allow that. Now, in any case, or these valves, if it is not functioning properly, or incompetency of these valves will lead to the flow of blood from deep veins to superficial veins. That leads to engorgement, dilatation of the superficial veins, which can be seen in the lower part or in the lower leg. Those are called as varicose veins. Communication between superficial to deep veins are called as perforators. There are two types of perforators, a direct perforator and an indirect perforator. We will discuss about the perforators later. Now, lymph is a clear fluid which is produced in the interstitial tissue spaces. The lymph is carried by the lymphatic capillaries. They form lymphatic vessels. Ultimately, they will be draining into veins. Any defect to the lymphatic vessels can lead to formation of edema, that is collection of fluid in the interstitial spaces. So I have explained regarding the bony features in my other class. So you can go through that as well. So elevations are called as ridge, greater trochanter of femur. You can see this is an example of it. You can just see that videos. This is a repeated slide. Okay, we'll talk about nerves. So nerves are the processes of a nerve cell. And what is a nerve cell? There is a neuron. A nerve cell bodies are located within the spinal cord and also in the dorsal root ganglion. This is a cut section of the spinal cord, cross section, where this is the gray matter and this is white matter. Gray matter contains collection of nerve cell bodies. White matter contains collection of nerve cell fibers. The nerve fibers are surrounded by some cells called Schwann cells. This is a nerve fiber. There are multiple Schwann cells in a nerve fiber. They form a discontinuous sheath called myelin sheath. Usually, the nerves which are myelinated looks white in color. The gaps between the myelin sheath is called knots of Ranvier. So there are two types of nerves in the body, myelinated fibers and non-myelinated fibers. In myelinated fibers, Schwann cell will encircle the nerve fiber multiple times. Whereas in non-myelinated fibers, Schwann cells will come close to the axons and they covers it, but it is not going to encircle multiple times as it happens in a myelinated fiber. So these are unmyelinated fibers. So both the fibers, Schwann cells, are related, but in myelinated fiber, Schwann cells will surround a single axon multiple times, as you can see here. This axon and Schwann cells are encircling it many times. Spinal nerves are the nerves which are coming out from the spinal cord, which are 31 pair in number, named as cervical, thoracic, lumbar, sacral, coccygeal. So there are 31 pairs of spinal nerves. In that, cervical are 8, thoracic 12, lumbar 5, sacral 5, and coccygeal single. So they are paired structures. All the spinal nerves will come out from the spinal cord, caudal to corresponding vertebra. So this is T1 spinal nerve passing below thoracic vertebra 1, L1 spinal nerve passing below the lumbar vertebra L1. But the cervical spinal nerves usually emerge cranial to the corresponding vertebra. As here, C1 is a spinal nerve that is passing above the corresponding vertebra, C1. So as we discussed before, spinal nerve is a nerve that is going to emerge from the spinal cord. Spinal nerve has got two roots, ventral root and a dorsal root. Both of them joins to form trunk of the spinal nerve. Later it divides into dorsal ramus and ventral ramus. Dorsal ramus goes to the back side of the body, divides into medial and lateral branches. Whereas the ventral ramus moves laterally. As it moves laterally, it gives a branch here, that is lateral cutaneous branch, which later divides into posterior and anterior branch. Now, the ventral ramus continues anteriorly again to reach the anterior aspect of the body, where it forms anterior cutaneous branch, later divides into medial and lateral branches. Spinal nerve is a mixed nerve which has a sensory and a motor component. This is the motor component and this is the sensory component. Sensory component, which is dorsal root, has a ganglion over this area, and that is dorsal root ganglion, which is collection of cell body. Ganglions are collection of cell bodies outside central nervous system, or they are seen in peripheral nervous system. Again, there's a ganglia here, which is called as sympathetic ganglia, related to the spinal nerve. Dorsal root ganglia, structurally, they are sensory nerve cell bodies, sensory ganglion, which are unipolar in structure. Whereas sympathetic ganglia, they are multipolar neurons. Sympathetic ganglia is connected to the spinal nerve via two roots. A white ramae communicans, which is seen laterally, and gray ramae communicans, which is seen medially. White ramae and gray ramae communicans. So the spinal nerve is a mixed nerve which contains a sensory as well as motor component. Now this is again the picture of a spinal cord, where this is the dorsal root and this is ventral root of the spinal nerve. Afferent nerves are called as sensory nerves, which carries sensation from the periphery to the brain. Efferent nerves are the motor nerves that carries sensation, or that carries impulses from the brain, from the spinal cord, from the central nervous system to the periphery. So this is afferent or sensory. that is going towards the brain or the spinal cord, efferent that is coming from the CNS to the periphery. So these are called as sensory nerves, these are called as motor nerves and other names. So as we described before, this is sympathetic ganglion, which is a component of autonomic nervous system, which is related to the spinal nerve. Now, autonomic nervous system has two components, sympathetic and parasympathetic component. Sympathetic component is the sympathetic trunk, which is a paired structure, can be seen on either side of the vertebra, starting from base of the skull up to the coccyx. At the coccyx, both the sympathetic chain unites at this point, and it forms a ganglion here, which is called as ganglion impar. These are sympathetic ganglions, which are connected by nerve fibers. Altogether, it forms sympathetic chain. So this is described in the other videos. This is also explained. Now let's see bursa and synovial sheaths. When two adjacent structures like muscles, tendon or skin, when they glide over each other, synovial sac is found in between the structures. So here there's a tendon and bone. So between that, there's a synovial sac, and this is called as a bursa. Bursa are usually filled with synovial fluid. So I think you're familiar with the synovial fluid, which is present in the synovial cavity, which is a type of joint, synovial joint. So again, in this bursa, synovial fluid is present. Synovial fluid is like a white of an egg. You can go back and see the videos on the joints, you'll understand better. So when there is an irritation or infection to the bursa, which is here, it can lead to bursitis. So this picture is showing allocranon bursitis, which is seen in the elbow, dorsal aspect of the elbow. So bursas, the function of bursa is to prevent the friction between the adjacent structures. So joints, I have a class on joints, so you can see that. There are different types of joints, and types of bones are also explained. So this is regarding instructions, general instruction for dissection. So usually we have a cadaver in the dissection hall, which is immersed in the tank, which is filled with formalin. So you should be taking care that the body is kept moist. It should not be dried at any cost. It should be kept moist. Otherwise, the structures will get dried and you cannot demonstrate the structures. So embalming is a procedure where the formalin, not only formalin, there are other chemicals which are injected into the arterial system of the dead person. There are some dissection instruments like scalpel, forceps. Forceps are of different types. So these are the forceps. This is a blunt forceps. This is a pointed forceps. In addition, to see smaller structures, you can use hand lens. This is artery forceps, which is used to hold the structures. This is tooth forceps. A tooth-like end can be seen. The scalpel handle, which has the blade. There are different types of blades in different size. as this is a curved blade, different sizes of blade, and this is scissor, which is also very useful in dissection. Now, how the structures are arranged in the dissection, we were seeing it, but once again, so this is an incision which is given at the skin, where after the skin or below the skin, there is superficial fascia, which contains fat, which contains a lot of nerves, superficial nerves, vessels, lymphatics. So dissection, in simple words, is a process of freeing structures from the tissue and demonstrating them very clearly. So let's see the structures here in layer wise: skin, superficial fascia, deep fascia. Below the deep fascia, there is muscle. Now, remove the skin from the superficial fascia in flaps so that we can replace it after the dissection, so that it can prevent drying of that part. And blood vessels, nerves, which are seen in the superficial fascia, which are larger, can be traced. But if it is very small, you cannot trace it. It is better not to waste time on tracing very small structures which are seen in superficial fascia. In the superficial fascia, nerves, vessels can be seen. As we can see here, some of the structures which are seen in the superficial fascia, some nerves, some vessels, veins can be seen here in this area. Coming to deep dissection, for that, deep fascia has to be removed. To remove the deep fascia is a little difficult because it is closely attached with the muscle, and we have seen it how it divides the muscles or region into different compartments. And even the deep fascia enters into the substance of the muscle. So careful on removing the deep fascia. Now, after removing the deep fascia, as this is the deep fascia, you can see here the deep fascia and the muscle here. After removing the deep fascia, the muscles are exposed. It's also useful to understand the exact attachment of the muscle. So this muscle here is levator scapulae. So the attachment is seen clearly to the vertebra and to the scapula. This is important to understand the action of the muscle. Thank you.